Good morning, and welcome to this University Day ceremony, which commemorates the 219th anniversary of the tangible beginning of the University of North Carolina, the laying of the cornerstone of Old East on October 12, 1793. It is our usual tradition to give you a brief history lesson at this point, but circumstances call for me to depart from my usual script. As many of you have probably heard by now, earlier this morning, President Bill Friday passed away. Our state has lost one of its most remarkable citizens. His influence on public higher education in North Carolina and across the nation is legendary. As UNC president, he governed and served with passion, integrity, and an abiding commitment to justice. He was tireless in his efforts to make higher education available to people from all walks of life, for their own benefit and for our state's future prosperity. Please join me in a moment of silence in memory of President Friday. Mr. Friday was exceedingly gracious in sharing his wise counsel with me when I became chancellor. I always admired his conviction to defend academic freedom and freedom of speech. It was only fitting that Bill joined us a year ago today on University Day to dedicate the speaker band marker in McCorkle Place, documenting the efforts that our own students and he made to overturn a misguided law. Our thoughts and prayers are with Ida and the Friday family. Even as we mourn the loss of President Friday, he would want us to celebrate the importance of this day for this university and for public higher education. We stand here today because our founders believed in the bold and challenging concept of public higher education. Leaders who came after them remain committed to it in good times and in bad. No leader embodied that commitment more than Bill Friday. This morning, we celebrate the accomplishments of the Carolina faculty during the past year and the achievements of Carolina alumni with the presentation of Distinguished Alumnus and Alumna Awards. We look to the future with a keynote speech from Professor Jamie Bartram. He will tell us about a new Carolina venture, a campus-wide academic focus for the next 2 years on the theme of water in our world. This year marks the 100th birthday of Caldwell Hall, the first permanent building constructed for the UNC School of Medicine. It is also the 90th anniversary of UNC's invitation into the Association of American Universities. Both events were milestones in Carolina's growth into the world-class research university that it is today. So it is fitting that this afternoon we will dedicate the new Genome Sciences Building, a space for faculty, students, and research staff working in the interdisciplinary area of genomics. Opening this facility is, in many ways, the culmination of the genomics initiative that Chancellor James Meeser announced on University Day in 2000. He said then that Carolina's historical strengths in the basic and health sciences present great opportunity. In such critical fields as genomics, our potential is limited only by the inadequate physical space for science. 12 years later, we can celebrate the fact that our potential is virtually unlimited. This new building joins more than 5 million square feet of new teaching, research, and patient care space at Carolina, constructed in the last decade through a historic mix of public and private support. We cannot speak too often about how North Carolina voters supported the UNC system with the historic 2000 higher education bond referendum, and how their vote of confidence helped Carolina leverage gifts, faculty research grants, and other financial sources to complete a $2.1 billion capital construction program, which transformed our campus. I urge you to learn more about this era in a new book by David Godshalk and Jonathan Howes titled The Dynamic Decade. The state of North Carolina will truly benefit from this investment for many years to come. Carolina is a great university. We may face challenges today, but looking at our history, we know that we can endure and excel. Carolina is still achieving great things because of all of you. And we will be even better in the future. Now it is my pleasure to recognize some important guests seated in the audience today. We are honored to have former chancellors Paul Hardin, Bill McCoy, and James Meeser here today. Would you please stand? In today's program, we recognize those people who have won Distinguished Teaching and Service Awards this year. Would all the winners with us please stand? The Carolina faculty recognizes exceptional junior faculty members each year with the Philip and Ruth Hettleman Prizes for Artistic and Scholarly Achievement. It is the only award that honors the full range of scholarship on this campus, and the list of previous recipients is an impressive one. The 2012 Hettleman Prize winners, and if you would stand when I call your name and then we'll recognize you, are Evan Dellen from the Departments of Medicine and Epidemiology, Melinda Maynor Lowry from the Department of History, Kim Rathmel from the Departments of Medicine and Genetics, and Yang Yang from the Department of Sociology. Congratulations to all of you. I would also like to welcome the retired faculty of the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill and ask them to stand. We are honored by your presence. If there are any new faculty members here, I'd like to ask them to stand as well. They're busy working on their grants, so. Oh, we have one, good. Thank you for coming. Please welcome Tom Ross, President of the University of North Carolina, who will bring greetings.
Good morning. Chancellor Thorpe, Mr. Mercer, Chairman Hargrove, honorees, faculty, staff, students, and friends of the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. I am truly proud and honored to be with you today to help celebrate the 219th University Day. I think of University Day as sort of an academic homecoming. It allows us to reconnect with our roots, roots that run more than 200 years deep in North Carolina soil. And it offers us a time to consider Carolina's beginnings, her proud and storied history, and this university's critical importance to the future of our entire state. On this special day, as Chancellor Thorpe has indicated, it somehow seems fitting that we pause to celebrate the life and memory of Bill Friday. President Friday lived a life that exemplified everything he has made our university and the state of North Carolina great. He was a man of unquestioned honor and integrity who devoted a lifetime of extraordinary leadership and service to the university and to the state that he loved so much. He was a man of deep courage and conviction who never backed away from doing the right things for our students, faculty, and the citizens of North Carolina. We have truly lost one of our state's most special treasures. Personally, President Friday was a mentor and role model to me throughout my career, and I am privileged to have followed in his footsteps as president of the University of North Carolina. He quite literally set the gold standard for university leadership, and it's safe to say that no one will be more respected or more influential in American higher education. Over the years, I have valued and appreciated his thoughtful perspective, his sage advice, and his insights about our state and its people. His life was a remarkable testament to the notion that one person can make a lasting difference and change the world for the better. He was an inspiration to us all, and we will all miss him deeply. On University Day, we come together as a community to reflect on Carolina's vast and ever-growing list of achievements and to acknowledge that those many successes would not have happened, could not have happened, without the past efforts and sacrifices, along with the very sizable investments made by previous and current generations. We are at a defining moment in our history, a time marked by challenges and uncertainty. While this university has been sorely tested at various times in its long history, it has always emerged stronger, with renewed energy and an even greater commitment to its vital mission. Today, we are being tested yet again, for it is indeed a sad time for a university when a leader of Chancellor Holden Thorpe's talent, vision, intellect, and integrity concludes that he needs to step aside for the good of the institution and his family. As reflected by the outpouring of support he received in the days following his announcement, many remarkable positive acts, actions, and activities have been happening every day, and each and every day because of his leadership, and because of the collective and passionate efforts of a brilliant faculty and dedicated staff. We owe Chancellor Thorpe our sincere and deep gratitude for the many accomplishments achieved to date, and for his unyielding commitment to spend the rest of his tenure putting any remaining negative matters behind us. Chancellor, on behalf of everyone who loves this place, this university, we thank you. We will have, I hope, many more times to say thank you, but we can never do it enough. As we move forward in the search for his successor, it will take the commitment of all of us who care about Carolina and all it stands for to guarantee its continued success. Today and in the years ahead, Bill Friday would demand, and we must, recommit ourselves to being the university of the people. It is our responsibility and our time. In doing so, we must continue to accept nothing less than excellence, the same excellence that has been the hallmark of this university for more than two centuries, and that still exists today at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. On this day, it is also important that we pause to celebrate all this university stands for and all that it does. We celebrate those who have led this institution in the past and those who lead it today. We must remind ourselves of the real value of what we have and renew our commitment to preserve it. Thank you for the privilege of being a part of this special day, and thank you for the enormous good each of you do on behalf of our students, each other, our university, and our state. And again, Thank you, Chancellor Thorpe, for your leadership and friendship. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom, and thank you all. Please welcome Charlie Mercer, representing the Board of Governors, who will bring greetings.
President Ross, Chancellor Thorpe, Chairman Hargrove, honorands, and distinguished guests, faculty, students, staff, and supporters of this university. It is with pleasure that I bring greetings on behalf of the University of North Carolina Board of Governors on this special Carolina Day, a day on which we celebrate October 12, 1793, when people gathered on this university's grounds to lay the cornerstone of the Old East Building, the cornerstone that laid the foundation for public higher education, not only here in North Carolina, but across our great country. Since 1793, other cornerstones have been laid. New buildings have been dedicated, honoring people who have made a difference in the life of this university. These buildings honor the founder of our university, William Richardson Davy, as well as courageous past presidents, David Lowry Swain, Francis Preston Venable, and Edward Kidder Graham. These buildings honor chancellors William Brantley Aycock and Robert Burton House. And speaking of chancellors, Chancellor Thorpe, thank you for your distinguished leadership and your exceptional service to this university. Buildings on this campus also honor cherished professors, James Phillips, Elisha Mitchell, William Chambers Coker, Blyden and Roberta Jackson, and Sonia Haynes Stone. And the senior class gift of 2002 is a monument to those unsung heroes whose work contributed to laying the cornerstones of this great university. We honor all of those people today. We also honor the extraordinary life and remarkable contributions of former University of North Carolina President William Friday. Over the past 219 years, this university's cornerstones have stood the weight of two centuries and borne the hopes and dreams of our great state. The cornerstone of commitment to providing quality education to the people of North Carolina, and commitment to this university's core missions of teaching, research, and public service to the citizens of North Carolina. The cornerstone of courage that has enabled this university to prevail in the face of adversity and obstacles to this institution. Courage that has made this university a shining light and beacon of hope during difficult times in our state's history. The cornerstone of consistency, consistent dedication to academic freedom and inquiry, and to fostering an enlightened citizenry, a consistency that for 200 years has made this university the taproot of our state, and given this university a singular place in the life of North Carolina and indeed our country. And the cornerstone of a covenant with the people of North Carolina that began in 1776 in Halifax, when our state's first constitution provided for the creation of one or more universities, and a covenant that continues to this very day and will last for generations to come. Thank you.
Thank you, Charlie. I would now like to introduce Wade Hargrove, Chair of the Board of Trustees.
Thank you, Chancellor Thorpe, and thank you, President Ross. On behalf of the Board of Trustees and all of us who love this place so much, thank you for your distinguished leadership and service to this university. On behalf of the Board of Trustees, I bring greetings, and I'd like to ask current and past members of the board to stand and be recognized at this time. It would be difficult, very difficult, to overstate how much their stewardship has meant over the years to this university. As you know, it's the university's birthday, and birthdays are a time to commemorate achievement and a time for hope, dreams, and aspirations for the future. The then novel notion back in 1789 that we all now take for granted of a, quote, public university, as you know, had its birth, its beginning, on this very campus. And the history of this university is indeed the history of all of public higher education in America. And it's a history in which all of us take great pride. From the university, Carolina alumni have led the nation, and they've led the state of North Carolina in science and education, in medicine and government, in public health, in the law, in the armed services, in defense of freedom, in the arts and athletics, and in the humanities. We honor five of the university's most distinguished alumni today. The remarkable contributions of these alumni are continuing testament to the value to the nation and to this great state of this university's contributions. It is, as President Ross noted, a challenging time for the university. The Reverend Martin Luther King said, "The ultimate measure of a man is not where he stands in moments of comfort, but rather where he stands in times of challenge and controversy." The same can be said of this university. In a time of adversity and challenge, Carolina, through the most capable and distinguished leadership of Chancellor Thorpe, has compiled an incredible record of achievement since we were here last year. It is this achievement, this record of achievement, this faculty, these students, that define this university. UNC, for the 11th time in a row, was ranked by Kiplinger as number one among the 100 best public colleges and universities that offer a world-class education at an affordable price. And even in a challenged economy, the university continues to reaffirm at every opportunity its commitment to the people of this state to keep the doors of the university open to all who otherwise qualify without regard to financial circumstance. We have produced more Rhodes Scholars than any other national public research university. And its faculty, our faculty, continues to receive national and international acclaim in the humanities, in the arts, and in science. Carolina, in this past year, rose from 16th to 9th in research funding among all private and public research universities. It's a remarkable achievement. In a very few short years, the university has risen 10 places, 10 spots, in the ranking since 2008. And by every metric traditionally applied to academic performance, the university continues to excel. It is consistently ranked in the top five public universities in the nation and among the top 40 in the world. Finally, the university, as Chancellor Thorpe noted, received an outpouring of support, financial and otherwise, from loyal alumni and friends in 2012. It was the second best year in fundraising in the history of the university, in the middle of perhaps the most severe recession of the lifetime of anybody in the room. That itself is an extraordinary vote of confidence in the university, its faculty, and its leadership. Carolina will continue, as it has in the past, of course, to educate the young and the old, and to provide opportunities for learning, for research, for robust, unencumbered debate, and for leadership training, as it has for over 200 years. About that, I have no doubt. So as we figuratively, and as evidenced by our presence today, celebrate our achievements and that of these five distinguished alumni, all of us look forward to many more birthdays of this university and many more commemorations of its contributions to this state and to the nation, and to the future generations of young and old that it will educate for the nation. Thank you.
Thank you, Wade. I'd now like to introduce Eric Montross, Chair of the General Alumni Association.
Thank you, Chancellor, President Ross. Thank you. As Chair of our General Alumni Association, I also would like to express on behalf of our alumni and the staff of the General Alumni Association the great sorrow that we do share today in the passing of President Friday. Also on behalf of the General Alumni Association and its more than 67,000 members, it is my privilege to join in congratulating this year's distinguished alumna and alumnus recipients. For 169 years, the General Alumni Association has embraced our mission of informing and involving Carolina alumni, as well as connecting and reconnecting Carolina's former students with their university. We are pleased to have been effective advocates for Carolina in our communities, in our professions, and with members of the North Carolina General Assembly. We understand that Carolina alumni, the university's only permanent constituency, have a great interest in assuring the value of our diplomas continues to appreciate over time. We look forward to continuing our work with the administration and trustees in support of today's students, who are tomorrow's alumni, and with our faculty, whose research, teaching, and service for 219 years has earned our university great respect and admiration across our state and around this world. Hark the sound.
Thank you, Eric. And now Jackie Overton, the chair of the employee forum.
Greetings, Chancellor Thorpe, President Ross, Chairman Hargrove, platform guests, campus community, especially in memory of our beloved President Friday. In my quest to want my speech to fit in, I was going to deal with the water theme. My original speech was entitled, "Water, Water Everywhere. Water, Water, Why Should We Care?" I am sure our speaker for today will sufficiently address the water topic, because from all indications, that is his passion. My passion is people, especially downtrodden people, people who feel invisible, people who feel they don't have a voice. So I'll stick with what and who I know. The Employee Forum celebrated its 20th anniversary in March at the fabulous Friday Center. The event featured remarks from our four chancellors, Hardin, McCoy, Meza, and Thorpe, with a keynote address by Kay Winberg Hovius, chief organizer and first forum chair. We also had a featured presentation by retired employee Jeffrey Bean. In 1998, Jeffrey wrote a poem entitled "Song of the University Worker." The forum adopted it as our official poem in 2008. The poem begins with a quote by Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. saying, if a man is called to be a street sweeper, he should sweep streets as Michelangelo painted, or Beethoven composed music, or Shakespeare wrote poetry. He should sweep streets so well that all the hosts of heaven and earth will pause to say, here lived a great street sweeper who did his job well. The poem goes on to highlight many occupations that university workers do: cutting grass, scrubbing floors, typing letters, pushing papers, directing traffic, managing processes. In the heat, in the cold, in the hurricane, in the snow. The constant refrain in the poem is, behind you, before you, beside you, with you. It is a continual reminder, especially to the staff, that although sometimes overlooked, our presence here is both incalculable and invaluable to the successful running of this great university. So, to the students, we say, behind you, before you, beside you, with you. The staff at Carolina will keep the halls, the labs, the grounds, the classrooms clean and safe and functional to help provide you with the ideal learning environment. We will protect you, we will nurture you, we will serve you. That's what we do. That's who we are. To the faculty, your wonderful regalia today, we say, behind you, before you, beside you, with you. The staff at Carolina will keep this university running and clean and safe, even during severe economic conditions or inclement weather conditions. We will do everything to help you flourish, because when you succeed, we succeed. That's what we do. That's who we are. To the Board of Governors, trustees, alumni, administration, we say, behind you, before you, beside you, with you. The staff at Carolina will continue to give you our best until UNC is the best. Scandals don't rock us, storms don't shock us, allegations don't stop us, because we know that fundamentally, at our core, we are better than what we have experienced in the past few years. We know that we are one of the premier learning institutions in the world, and we will do our part to keep it that way. That's what we do. That's who we are. Let me conclude my remarks by being a little non-traditional. This is one of the few this is one of the few events where faculty, staff, and students convene together. So I'm going to ask my friend and colleague Jan Boxel and the student leaders Will and Michael to come and join me as we salute our chancellor. To our beloved and beleaguered Chancellor Holden Thorpe, we say that for the next 8 months, behind you, before you, beside you, with you. You have been a true champion to us, and has given us unprecedented access to you, your office, your resources. Your commitment has been unfaltering. Your support has been unwavering. You will always have our commitment and support in return. That's what we do. That's who we are. Behind you. Before you. Beside you, and with you. We are the University of North Carolina, and we are Tar Heels, but let's all say it together. Behind you, before you, beside you,
with you. Thank you.
The people say amen to Jackie Overton. Ah. Thank you all very much. Thank you, Jackie. It is an honor to be part of the staff of the University of North Carolina and to work with all of you to do all the things that you just said. Thank you for your support and for allowing me to stand with you. They've already been recognized, but we'll recognize again Will Limonstall, the student body president, and Michael Bertucci, president of the Graduate and Professional Students Federation. One of the great pleasures of University Day is the opportunity to acknowledge the achievements of former students. Our alumni are truly impressive, and their loyalty and affection are represented through the work of the General Alumni Association, which this year marks its 169th anniversary. Created in 1971 by resolution of the faculty, the Distinguished Alumna and Alumnus Awards recognize the outstanding contributions of our alumni. Recipients are approved by the Faculty Council and the Board of Trustees upon the recommendation of their respective committees. At this time, I would like to ask all the former recipients of the Distinguished Alumna and Alumnus Awards to stand and be recognized. And will the past presidents and chairs of the General Alumni Association who are with us please stand? Thank you. To present the 2012 awards, I ask Executive Vice Chancellor and Provost Bruce Carney and Professor Joseph Farrell, Secretary of the Faculty, to come forward. Will Gregory S. Allgood please come forward?
Greg Allwood is a water wizard. Armed with a Carolina undergraduate degree in biology, a master's degree from the Gillings School of Public Health, and a PhD from NC State, Greg landed a job with Cincinnati-based Procter & Gamble. There, he led a team that developed a product called Pure Water Purifier that, with a little stirring and time, causes impurities in water to coagulate so they can be filtered out through a cloth. It precipitates not just stuff like dirt and bacteria, but parasites like Cryptosporidium and Giardia, which cause severe and sometimes fatal intestinal illnesses. Now that is wizardry on a global scale. Pure was named by Popular Mechanics magazine as one of the top 10 world-changing innovations of 2008. In another act of wizardry, Allgood persuaded Procter & Gamble to take a product that wasn't making lots of money and use it to create the Children's Safe Drinking Water Program. The result is a life-saving nonprofit program that has helped provide people around the globe with more than 4 billion liters of clean, safe drinking water. Allgood's work has earned him many awards, including the World Technology Award for the Environment in 2009, the Breakthrough Innovation Award from Popular Mechanics in 2008, the Strategic Vision Award from the Center for Strategic and International Studies, and the Gold Medallion from Johns Hopkins University's Center for Communication Programs. Carolina's Department of Environmental Sciences and Engineering named him its Distinguished Alumnus of the year 2006. for outstanding contributions to global public health. The University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill is pleased to confer upon Gregory Stanley Allgood this Distinguished Alumnus Award.
Will Mary Marshall Clark please come forward?
Mary Marshall Clark is director of the Columbia Center for Oral History. She graduated from Carolina in 1975 with a BA in Religious Studies and Psychology and went on to earn two master's degrees from Union Theological Seminary. Over the past decade, she has interviewed dozens of people whose life work changed the world, such as Archbishop Desmond Tutu and the late Congresswoman Bella Abzug. Clark is one of the founders of the International Oral History Association. She is a co-principal investigator of the September 11 Oral History Narrative and Memory Project and has directed projects on the Carnegie Corporation, Atlantic Philanthropies, the Council on Foreign Relations, the Japanese internment on the East Coast, the Apollo Theater, and women in the visual arts. Clark writes on issues of memory, the mass media, trauma, and ethics in oral history. Her current work focuses on the global impact of torture and detention policies at Guantanamo. Mary Marshall has been president of the United States Oral History Association and has served on the Executive Council of the International Oral History Association. She has lectured and delivered seminars at Columbia University's Teachers College, Barnard College, Sarah Lawrence College, the City University of New York, and many other institutions. In addition, she has lectured in Brazil and the Netherlands on topics related to oral history and memory. For outstanding contributions in the field of oral history, the University of North Carolina is pleased to confer on Mary Marshall Clark this Distinguished Alumna Award.
Will Deborah Parham Hobson please come forward?
As Associate Administrator for HRSA's HIV/AIDS Bureau, Deborah Parham Hobson is responsible for managing the Ryan White HIV/AIDS Treatment Modernization Act of 2006. This $2 billion program funds medical care, treatment, referrals, and support services for uninsured and underserved people living with HIV disease, as well as training for healthcare professionals. Grantees funded by the Ryan White program provide services to more than 530,000 people every year. She also directs a multi-million dollar global HIV/AIDS program with training, care, and treatment activities in Africa, Asia, and the Caribbean. Parham Hobson holds the rank of Assistant Surgeon General and Rear Admiral in the Commissioned Corps of the United States Public Health Service. She completed a variety of assignments in the HIV/AIDS Bureau, served as Deputy Chief of Staff in the Office of the Surgeon General, and worked as a Public Health and Budget Analyst and Chief Nurse for the National Health Service Corps. She is the recipient of numerous honors and awards, including the U.S. Public Health Service Meritorious Service Medal, the Chief Nurse Officer Award, the Black Commissioned Officers Hildreth A. Poindexter Award, the DHHS Secretary's Award for Distinguished Service, and the Uniformed Services University of the Health Sciences Exceptional Service Medal. Parham Hobson received her undergraduate degree in Nursing and Health from the University of Cincinnati and her Master of Science and Doctor of Philosophy degrees in Health Policy and Administration from Carolina's Gillings School of Public Health. For outstanding accomplishment in the field of public health, the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill is pleased to confer on Deborah Parham Hobson this Distinguished Alumna Award.
Will Jonathan Reckford please come forward?
Congresswoman Millicent Fenwick once said, "Influence comes out of the work that you've done and the things you've stood for." She could have been describing her grandson, Jonathan Reckford. Today, Jonathan is Chief Executive Officer of Habitat for Humanity International. Soon after graduating from Carolina, Reckford was awarded the Henry Luce Scholarship, which gave him the opportunity to live and work for a year in Asia. He worked in marketing for the Olympic Organizing Committee, preparing for the 1988 Olympic Games in Seoul, and coached the South Korean national rowing team. Returning to the United States, Reckford earned an MBA degree from Stanford and had a successful career in the world of business. While he was acquiring the skills needed to succeed in the business world, a professor's words struck home with him. The same skills that will make you a success in the for-profit world also are desperately needed in the not-for-profit world. Always active in his local faith community, Reckford found an avocation helping pastors deal with the management side of church life. That volunteer service turned into full-time ministry and then to Habitat for Humanity, an organization that was a good fit with his personal faith and values and the business skills needed to lead a nonprofit with excellence. Reckford grew up in Chapel Hill and is a frequent visitor to his hometown and alma mater. He gave the 2009 Frank Porter Graham Lecture in Excellence at the Tapping Banquet of the Order of the Golden Fleece and has been awarded honorary degrees by Stevenson University and Wake Forest University. For outstanding contributions to humanity through charitable endeavors, the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill is pleased to confer on Jonathan T. M. Reckford this Distinguished Alumnus Award.
The Edward Kidder Graham Faculty Service Award recognizes a member of the faculty whose work exemplifies the university's mission of service to the state of North Carolina, the nation, and the world. The award calls to mind President Graham, who led the university to embrace public service and make the state and all of its practical problems a legitimate field of study. His directive is carried out today through the university's modern mission to extend knowledge-based service worldwide. This year's recipient is Farrell Guillory, Professor of the Practice of Journalism at the UNC School of Journalism and Mass Communication and adjunct faculty member in the Department of Public Policy. Will Farrell Guillory please come forward?
After 20 years of service in multiple roles on the staff of the Raleigh News and Observer, Farrell Guillory joined Carolina's faculty in 1997. As a star presenter on the Carolina bus tour, he gave dozens of new faculty and staff a deep understanding of how Carolina makes its campus coextensive with the boundaries of the state, and how individual faculty members can extend their knowledge base to address significant challenges facing the state and the region. Guillory is a recognized mediator and broker between academic research and public policy. In 1997, he founded the Program on Public Life to build bridges between Carolina and the governmental, journalistic, and civic leaders of the state. In addition to his responsibilities at the School of Journalism and Mass Communication, Guillory is a senior fellow at MDC Incorporated, a nonprofit research organization that focuses on economic and community development. As a writer in residence at MDC in 1995, Guillory took the lead in launching The State of the South, a major report on regional economic and demographic trends. He is co-author with George Altrey of The Carolinas Yesterday, Today, and Tomorrow, published in 1999, a work commissioned by the trustees of the Duke Endowment. Guillory was inducted into the North Carolina Journalism Hall of Fame in 2007. for outstanding service to the people of the state of North Carolina and the American South. The University of North Carolina is pleased to honor Farrell Guillory with the 2012 Edward Kidder Graham Public Service Award.
We will now enjoy a long-standing University Day tradition as we listen to the UNC Chamber Singers, directed by Professor Susan Klebanow, and they will perform The Water is Wide, arranged by Craig Hella Johnson. Professor Brent Wissick will play the cello, and Mary Hamilton will accompany them on the piano. Thank you so much. Wonderful. Please welcome Professor Jan Boxall, Chair of the Faculty, who will introduce today's guest speaker.
Before introducing today's speaker, on behalf of the faculty at UNC, I would like to express my deepest sympathy to the family of one of the most important figures in dedication and commitment to higher education, but especially to the University of North Carolina, President Bill Friday. He was a great friend to all of us, and in these past 2 years has been an important advisor to me and to others. He will be missed, but I will miss him. It is fitting that today we celebrate the very university that was so important to him. As chair of the faculty, it is my honor and privilege to represent the brilliant and most amazing faculty here at UNC. And today, it is my honor to introduce one of those, our colleague, Professor Jamie Bartram, director of the Water Institute at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, and Don and Jennifer Holdsworth, Distinguished Professor of Environmental Sciences and the Engineering at the Gillings School of Public Health. Dr. Bartram came to UNC from the World Health Organization, where he was coordinator of water, sanitation, hygiene, and health program, and where he led reform of international monitoring and standard-setting activities, and where he received international recognition for leadership in evidence-based policy and good practice. In his extensive career, Dr. Bartram has worked on various aspects of the connection between water and health, including technologies for urban sanitation renewal, management systems for drinking water safety, and rural drinking water supply, water scarcity, climate change, and more. Dr. Bartram holds degrees in microbiology and environmental and public health from the University of Surrey in his native country of Great Britain. In his more than 20 years of work on issues related to the environment and health and water safety and sanitation, he has worked in over 65 countries and is conversant in several languages. In his short time here at Chapel Hill, Dr. Bartram has been very active, setting up the Water Institute and serving as co-director of the university-wide academic theme, Water in Our World, along with Senior Associate Dean Terry Rhodes. He's still learning Southern, but let's give him a warm Southern welcome. Please welcome Dr. Bartram.
President Ross, Chancellor Thorpe, distinguished alumni, members of the Platform Party, colleagues. Jackie, colleagues means faculty, staff, and students. Yeah. Colleagues. I'm here to talk about water, and it may seem that water is an odd focus for a University Day speech. It's not really the stuff that provokes wild academic excitement. And as long as it flows from the showerhead, pours from the faucet, flushes the toilet, maybe waters the yard, we barely register its presence. Contrast the fact that the inquiring minds of humankind have only ever yet found liquid water on a thin film on the surface of one planet, our planet. And it's on that film that we depend, absolutely. Civilizations have evolved around it and have crashed when they exceeded its bounds. Communities have prospered because of it and foundered on its exhaustion. Populations have grown because of the sustenance that it enabled and died because of the diseases with which it's associated. Moving water transcends cultures. It provides the sights and sounds that we all associate with rest and relaxation. And as water may seem an odd theme, I may seem an odd speaker for today. I'm not a Tar Heel born, nor am I a Tar Heel bred, nor am I a UNC alum. But I can claim that moving here 2 years ago closed a loop that was left open more than half a century ago. Herman Beatty was a 1917 graduate of this university, and he went on to receive the first PhD in sanitary engineering ever awarded by a US university. He returned here and became the Dean of Engineering, leaving this university only to become the first head of environmental health at the World Health Organization. That was the role that I inherited 50 years later, and which I then left to come back here. Now, my due diligence in Geneva involved asking anyone I knew with a US accent or a US education, what they knew about UNC. Now, I confess, I have since arriving here learned that that's not an optimal research method, and I should have sought IRB approval before embarking on this work. But my respondents were remarkably clear. They were absolutely consistent. They referred to the fact, every single one of them referred to the fact, that at Carolina, people work, support one another and work together. And when they told me that, it wasn't something glib, reassuring, and cozy. It was something that defined what this university is about. What I'd like to do today is make to you the case that that importance of water, combined with a defining characteristic of our university community, offer an exceptional opportunity for world-changing academic endeavor. And I'll call on two advocates to help me in that. Since taking office, my first advocate, Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, has marked World Water Day every year. And she summarized in 2010, saying, "Water represents one of the great diplomatic and development opportunities of our time. It's not every day that you find an issue where effective diplomacy and development will allow you to save millions of lives, feed the hungry, empower women, advance national security, and protect the environment, and demonstrate to billions of people that the United States cares. Water is that issue." She referred to saving millions of lives, and the evidence supports her. Lack of water and sanitation kills more people than HIV, malaria, and accidents all combined. And in North Carolina and across the US, investment in simple water systems brought typhoid, then a major killer, under control in the first half of the 20th century. Today, UNC researchers provide evidence to support the formulation of new international development targets. They lead work, for example, in China, where they remedy toxic algae in a lake that supplies water to 12 million people. And they collaborate with private sector partners, like P&G, on evaluating and propagating simple life-saving interventions. Yet key complex research questions remain. How do we prevent the waterborne disease outbreaks that affected more than 500,000 Americans in the 1990s? And how do we deliver sustainable services to billions of people who lack them worldwide? Secretary of State Clinton also referred to feeding the hungry. Just this month, we've seen on the news painful images of starving children in Somalia, and we've seen footage of barren fields in the world's breadbasket, the American heartlands. Drought is a matter of life and death for subsistence farmers. And in the US, it means not only that food prices here will jump by perhaps 5%, but it also limits the availability of commodities like corn and soybean internationally. Again, our researchers are engaged, looking at innovative ways to redistribute risk, financial insurance-based mechanisms to reduce the impact of drought, and leading the development of cyber infrastructure to enhance access to data that's vital for effectively managing water resources. But again, the need for evidence to inform us on how to do better challenges research. How to cope with ever scarcer water matters here, it matters nationally, and it matters internationally. And yet, adaptation to a changing climate is insufficient, and our understanding of how to adapt to a changing climate is inadequate. What about empowering women? Today, the average woman in rural Africa will spend a quarter of her time collecting and carrying water. Globally, girls lag boys in achieving educational targets, and the lack of water is a cause. Girls miss school when, like their mothers, they shoulder the burden of collecting water. And they are absent and drop out early for the lack of privacy and security, something as simple as a toilet in which to practice menstrual hygiene. Again, our researchers are involved, exploring the practical implications of the recent recognition of a human right to water and sanitation, what it means, what it comprises, how to measure compliance with it, and how to support its implementation. And again, basic questions remain unanswered. Evidence suggests that water planning and management are more effective and more efficient when women are involved. We shouldn't be surprised. But it also confirms that often they are not. And how to enable and secure that participation still remains unclear. Secretary of State Clinton also referred to national security. She reiterated that at the UN General Assembly just 2 weeks ago, saying that water is fundamental now to peace and to security. A National Intelligence Council report that was prepared during her leadership reached worrying conclusions that water-related problems would lead to the instability of countries, and that instability, combined with other factors, may lead to country failures. That water may be increasingly used in terrorism and inter or intra-country leverage and conflict. That depletion of groundwater for irrigation in areas like the Middle East and the Western US would stress national and global food markets. And that water shortages and pollution would adversely affect the economic performance of countries through energy generation, manufacturing, resource extraction. I confess when I read this, it was kind of a bit like I'd expected from a national security report. What shocked me was the next part. That report went on to conclude that improving water management provided opportunities to cope with all of those concerns. I can barely imagine a more wide-ranging, exciting, and influential research agenda. Understanding of every single one of those challenges and opportunities is insufficient. And finally, protecting the environment is perhaps so linked to water that it needs no explanation. It's fundamental to the ecosystems of which we are part and on which we depend. Those ecosystems have value in biodiversity and conservation, through natural beauty and enhancement of our quality of life, by supporting industries like tourism and fishery, and through the natural treatment services that they provide us for the wastes that we pour into them. Here and abroad, those ecosystems and the services that they provide us are threatened. We use, for example, Lake Victoria, the third biggest lake in the world, which has been systematically diminished by population growth, invasive species, agricultural runoff, and industrial effluence, undermining subsistence fishery, degrading beauty, leading to the extinction of half the kitchlid fish species that once shared this planet with us. Here in North Carolina, climate change may fundamentally affect the future of our Outer Banks. And responding to the energy demands that we experience brings the potential impacts of fracking to fresh waters and of offshore drilling to coastal waters. Again, UNC researchers are engaged, determining the value of ecosystem services to humankind, investigating the effects of the Deepwater Horizon oil rig spill, and developing state-of-the-art models to predict storm surges from hurricanes and tropical storms. And yet we still know so little about some truly urgent and complex issues. For example, the connections between the demands we make on water, energy, and food, densely interdependent, and the way in which those demands are driven by both a growing and an ever more demanding population, whether locally, nationally, or internationally. Clearly, Secretary of State, the US Secretary of State, sees water as a critical opportunity. Holden, you set the bar for us when you described our to-do list as nothing less than the greatest challenges of our time. You set the bar, we jumped. Just a few months ago, we committed to mobilize around a common theme that was facing our society, and we adopted water not only as this university's first ever campus-wide theme, but the first two-year theme of any US university. Here, we're already developing new courses with collaborations across disciplines and among schools, expanding interdisciplinary research initiatives. We're celebrating the vibrancy, the power, and the beauty of water through new creative works in the visual and performing arts with student, faculty, and visiting artists from all over our world. And we're recognizing and securing the added value of combining the perspectives from different disciplines within humanities and sciences, combining those to give greater insight on how to challenge, how to confront today's complex water challenges. I think my second advocate, Charles Fishman, captured the vision of this theme better than any of us in his book, The Big Thirst. He said, "The goal is not just to bring water issues to the prominence for students, no matter their area of study. The frank ambition of the two-year effort will be to make Carolina a global center of water expertise and innovation, to do for water what, for example, Stanford does for Silicon Valley. Remarkably, there isn't any place like that in the US today." Earlier today, we all gathered by the old well, and as far as I can tell, UNC is the only university in the world to have a piece of water infrastructure as its official symbol. Today, it serves mainly as a stunning photographic backdrop and a place where our students, by tradition, take a drink for good luck. But for many years, we should not forget that it served as the source of water for the inhabitants of our student residences, for everything from drinking through to washing. In 1923, long after the well was converted to the form that we saw today, a survey of tenant farmers in North Carolina showed that none had running water and 8 of 175 had outside privies. In case anyone's in any doubt, the ones that didn't have outside privies didn't have inside privies either. That's roughly the situation of rural Somalia today. In less than 100 years, this state has transformed itself. This university contributed to that transformation, and managing water contributed to that transformation. Today, a new cycle of water challenges confront North Carolina, the US, and the world. These are challenges that will demand interdisciplinary international initiatives, initiatives that will deliver financial innovation in managing water supplies, technological innovation in augmenting water resources, scientific innovation in understanding the health and ecosystem impacts of new contaminants, social innovation in bringing water and sanitation to the unserved, policy innovation to address threats such as climate change, and artistic innovation to raise awareness of global water challenges and convey the universality of water. These are challenges that require vision and cooperation to solve. They're challenges that require evidence to inform policy and to improve practice. They're challenges that call for academic leadership. Colleagues, I believe that we have a rare, possibly unique opportunity. In a university that can both celebrate water and study water, that benefits from faculty, staff, and student bodies that pull together. And thanks to the giants on whose shoulders we stand, and one of whom we lost earlier today, we have the opportunity to become a leader, the academic leader, for a defining challenge of the 21st century. And if we choose to take that opportunity, we have the capacity to leave this state, this nation, and our world a better place. Thank you.
Thank you, Jamie, for a perfect talk. We're so proud that you're here, so proud of what we're doing with the two-year theme and with water, and I can't imagine a better way to demonstrate the breathtaking scope and excellence of the research and teaching of this great university. So thank you for being with us today. As you leave Memorial Hall after the ceremony, we are, normally we just go outside, but we're going to go up the aisle today, and if you'll follow us, There's a flower. There are flowers and baskets outside, and we will place them at the old well in honor of President Friday. I would like to thank the members of the ceremonial band and to Jeff Fuchs, band director, for their performance today. And as they play, please stand and join in singing our alma mater, and remain standing as the recessional occurs.